Growing up with an interest in motorsport, the German DTM racing series has always been a series I've been interested in, particularly the close-knit racing along with the high aero downforce on these cars always makes for an impressive scene. However, it's not that often that we actually get to dig in deep and find out a few of the details about what makes these cars go. We're here at Goodwood with this 2018 Mercedes-AMG C63 DTM car. Now, it isn't the current model car, and there have been some changes for the 2019 season. However, it's still a good opportunity to find out what went into last year's model. While on the outside, these cars may resemble the factory road car that you can buy off the showroom floor, and of course that's the sales point for manufacturers such as Mercedes. Once we dive in deep, you find out that there's really not a lot of factory componentry in the cars. It actually starts with a spec carbon fiber monocoque chassis, and this is the same chassis used across all of the cars irrespective of the manufacturer. This is done for cost-cutting measures, along with achieving some kind of parity between the different manufacturers. Interestingly enough, this particular spec chassis is exactly the same as used in the Japanese Super GT series. Now, that monocoque chassis is very similar to what we see in the likes of Formula One. It's very, very strong and very, very stiff, plus it also adds a safety element to protect the driver in the case of an accident. From here, the manufacturers are free to adapt their own bodywork onto the spec chassis, and of course that bodywork is all developed in carbon fiber to aid keeping that weight as low as possible. The aerodynamics are also tightly controlled, and this is one of the areas I've always loved with DTM. You can see all of the aerodynamic appendages around the car, in particular the intricate details that are used down the sides of the car along with the exhaust exits on each side of the cockpit. An interesting aspect that I picked up on was the ability to quickly change the angle of the rear wing. This doesn't require much in the way of tools and can be done very quickly in a pit stop. There's guides on the uprights for the rear wing so that the mechanics adjusting the wing can really easily dial in an accurate angle for the wing to suit a different track or the specific driver's preferences. The engine in this instance is a 4-litre Mercedes-AMG V8. It produces around about 500 horsepower. Naturally aspirated, revving to 8,000 RPM. Now, we don't have a lot of details on the inner workings of that particular engine. This is still closely guarded by Mercedes, and that's understandable. However, in this form, to achieve some kind of parity between the different engines used in the class, the engine does need to breathe through a pair of 28mm restrictors. So ultimately, this restricts the maximum airflow into the engine, and then it's really up to the manufacturer to do the best job possible of extracting as much power from that airflow as they can. What we can see is, to aid weight distribution, the engine is mounted very far back in the chassis, and what this does is makes it impossible to fit a traditional transmission on the back of the engine. There's simply not enough room. It would be essentially sitting where the driver needs to be. So in order to get around this, as well as again to aid weight distribution, there is a controlled spec transaxle fitted to the rear of the car. In this case, it is a Hewlands 6-speed transaxle. This is a paddle shift dog engagement gearbox. It uses a conventional mechanical LSD fitted to that. The gear ratios, again, are standardised across the entire class, making sure that there is no advantage to be had between different manufacturers in this area. In order to get drive from the engine back to that transaxle, a prop shaft is used, which runs straight off the back of the crankshaft. And the clutch, which is only used for getting the car off the start line, is also fitted to the transaxle in the rear of the car. This helps with achieving a weight distribution as close to 50-50 front to rear as possible. One of the obvious aspects with any of the DTM cars is the complexity of the suspension arrangement. What we can see, though, is the use of an inboard mounted suspension damper, and this is actuated via push rods through a bell crank. An interesting aspect to do with safety that we did pick up is that in the event of a major accident, it isn't uncommon for the engine to end up separating from the chassis. And when this happens, this can result in a potential for fire with fuel spilling out of the ruptured fuel lines. Now, this is actually dealt with in the DTM class using dry brake quick release connectors for the fuel lines. These are set up so in the event that the engine breaks away from the chassis, these are designed to break free, and this will seal the fuel lines, making sure sure that no fuel escapes, which could create a fire. In another attempt to control costs in the chassis, interestingly enough, the entire wiring harness for the chassis is again a spec part. So this is the same spec wiring harness that is used across all of the manufacturers. Now, of course, that's not going to allow you to attach that wiring harness to a variety of different engines. So here, this runs up to a bulkhead connector at the firewall. From here, each of the individual manufacturers will make up their own wiring harness to adapt to their engines. The electronics package in the car is complete Bosch from start to finish. This begins with a Bosch MS5.1 ECU, which is in charge of the engine control, along with the shifting for the paddle shift system with that Hewlands 6-speed transaxle. Power distribution to all of the circuits in the car is controlled with a Bosch PBX190. So this replaces the traditional fuses and relays that we'd see in more budget spec cars. This is a solid state electronic system controlling the current flow and power supply to all of the circuits in the car. The final part of the package is the Bosch DDU driver display. So this acts as a driver display, giving the driver all of the relevant information that he needs to know, as well as displaying any warnings that may become active while the car's out on track. This also acts as a central logging hub, logging all of the relevant information from the engine control unit, as well as any other chassis sensors that the race engineers need in order to improve the car. And an interesting aspect here, the data is logged into the dash itself, but in order to quickly retrieve that data in a pit stop, there is a remotely mounted military specification USB stick that can be quickly removed as the car comes into the pits. Looking at the steering wheel, there is a lot of adjustability there for the driver. It is interesting though to just note that these cars don't use any driver aids. There is no ABS fitted to the car. There is also no traction control, but the adjustability on that steering wheel allows various mapping options to be controlled. There are, of course, on the back of the steering wheel, paddles for upshift and downshift. There is also a third paddle which actuates a line locker, and this is used on the start line to prevent the car creeping before the start lights go out. Now, since aerodynamics are so important in the DTM class, it's worth mentioning that the aero downforce on this car is a little hard to get solid details on. Talking to the Mercedes engineers, I was told that at around 200 kilometers an hour, the car produces enough downforce to drive upside down. Given that we also know that with the driver and fuel on board, these cars weigh around 1150 kgs, it's not too difficult to do your own maths and figure out approximately how much downforce the cars are producing. Probably one more reason why the likes of driver aids such as traction control and ABS maybe not quite so critical in the DTM class. And of course, this brings back some of the requirements for the driver to actually work a little bit harder rather than relying on electronics to pick up the pieces if they don't get it quite right.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.